a religious nutcase over there. There's a religious nutcase over there. There's a religious nutcase over there. There's a religious nutcase over there. Hyde Park religious nutcases have you surrounded. And white. So it must be true. What nonsense. We all have the right to worship whichsoever God we choose. And if you choose not to worship a God, you have that right as well. But these nutcases come and tell you that their God is better than another God. Come and worship my God. And if you don't worship their God, they threaten you. They tell you that if you don't believe, you're going to perish in a lake of fire.
There's only one God.
I just say
this. Gold, oil and diamonds, that's God.
But those of you who believe this bullshit, look at that nutcase there. And look at that nutcase there. And when you die, you're not going to be with these motherfuckers for 5 minutes. You're going to be with them forever and ever and ever. Think about that for a while. I'll take my chances in hell, where it's hot.
Everyone's having a good time.
I'm from the Caribbean. I'm used to the heat. Rumor has it there's a barbecue in hell 24 hours a day. Nonsense. In fact, when I think about it, why would I want to go to heaven? I have never seen a picture of a black angel in my life. And I know that as a black man at 6'2", weighing over 200 pounds, if I end up in heaven, I know that you white people will use me for security purposes. Now, look after your own pearly gates. I ain't going nowhere. However, we are all the same people, regardless of sex, race, creed, color, sexual orientation, political persuasion, religious denomination. We are all the same people. So why do we fuss, fight, murder, maim, and kill each other in the name of religion? Hands up if you are Christian. Do you mind coming a little closer, sir? Hands up if you are Muslim. Hands up if you are Jewish. Ah, a black Jew. Why not? My brother, as a Christian, do you believe your God is the God?
Yes.
And the only God?
Yes. Do you believe that the Muslim and
he Jewish says he does believe that the Muslims
and Jewish religion
and Jewish religion have the same God. So Muslims and Jews have the same God, and you have
and
a different.
No, mine's the same.
And the Christians. Yes. So you all worship.
Yes.
Explain to me, why is it that you're all fighting against each other?
Stupid people.
An enlightened Christian. You're a Muslim, sir. Do you believe your God is the only God?
Yep.
Are you also aware that Christians worship the same God as you? Perhaps with variations. Why do you assume that Muslims, Christians, and Jews are fighting one another?
Your guess is as good as mine.
Sorry, sir?
No idea.
It's interesting because you all worship the same prophets. Now, sir, and I'm in no way attacking you. Because when we look at the books, and especially European, Eurocentric Christians who claim that Islam is a foreign religion. Are you aware of that?
Yes.
We have those in America, those in France, those in Europe, across Europe, who say that Islam is a foreign religion. Let me say this. Christianity is a foreign religion to Europe. Can you tell me the name of one prophet from the Bible who comes from Europe? Take your time. All the prophets from the Bible came from the Middle East and Africa. All. So how do we get in the Christian Bible Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? 2,000 years ago, called Matthew. Hello, John. Where did these names come from?
I suppose they're probably given because we couldn't say the original names.
They're probably given because we couldn't say the original names. So what were the original names? You don't know. My brother, I'm not throwing stones at you because I believe that we are all the same people. If we don't fuss and fight and murder each other in the name of religion, we murder each other of race. So, there are those among us who assume that the darker your complexion, the darker your skin color, the less worthy you are, the less intelligent you are.
Tell God that he's insulted if you do things like that. Sir. He's made all of us. Sir. He is insulted. That's God you're insulting. He will not tolerate self-insult. He'd smash you so hard, he'll make face
the
of you. What happened to the Nazis? Stalin on his deathbed was paralyzed. The Nazis
the
were
reality
finished.
Is, the lighter your skin.
The Japanese skin, got two nuclear bombs.
The lighter your anger. Skin. Yes. The whiter you are, the more privileges you get in society. And that society is not just around Europe, but around the world. We still have white supremacy in existence. White supremacy. If you are an Arab, the lighter skinned Arab you are, is the better you are seen. If you are Indian, or Asian, the lighter skinned Indian, the lighter skinned Asian, the better you are.
Why? Because the people at the top, they came in.
Why? He says because the people at the top.
They were the people who came in. It was the South Indians who were conquered by the people coming from the North. It was the North who were the
South
who conquered
the North.
Sir? Yes.
Let's not talk nonsense.
Well, I'm listening to you. I'm sure you'll do a very good job.
I'm sure I will do a very good job. And you're doing a very good job of soaking it up.
No.
Sir,
right.
We have the notions of white supremacy.
I am.
Now, when we look at white supremacy, many people look at slavery and believe that the enslavement of black Africans was something mired in racism.
No, it's done by Africans.
No,
by whites, it's done by
no.
Everyone
slavery was mired in capitalism.
No, rubbish. It was there.
He says rubbish.
I'll tell you why.
Sir, yes. Hold on.
Okay.
Let's get into a debate.
Okay.
Why were black people taken as slaves from Africa to the Caribbean?
It's very simple. They were sold by the tribes.
They were sold
the
by the tribes.
So on the side, they raided the people.
On the side, then they raided
sold them to whites.
They sold them to whites. Hold on, sir.
Yeah, no,
sir, you're missing something.
I'm not.
What was the white man doing in Africa?
Exactly.
Well, what was anybody doing anyway?
Sir!
We had the technology!
Sir, you said, he says that black people in Africa were selling blacks to white people.
And Arabs.
But there is
Arabs
a big
well.
Piece of the story missing.
Exactly.
Sir, and in Africa, of course, there were people who were captured as prisoners of war.
And so?
And when they were captured as prisoners of war, which is the fundamental difference, many times they were put to death. The white man who had discovered sugar in the Caribbean had used the native Arawaks and Caribs to farm the sugar, and they died. They couldn't survive. They then used Irish white people, and the whites couldn't survive in the heat. Hold on, sir. Hold on, sir. I'm saying to you that when they arrived in Africa, they arrived primarily as traders, explorers, and they saw the need for labor. They saw that black people could work in the heat. So black prisoners of war were sold to white people, as well as white slave merchants capturing their own slaves independently. Hold on, sir.
Can I ask you something?
And the majority of the slave trade was white, independent slave masters.
There were no words.
You cannot forget, sir.
They may have had better technology.
Sir, Queen Elizabeth I.
Yeah.
Your queen.
Not mine, no, she's dead. I'm
your
alive.
Former queen.
Aye. I'll go for any old queen I can find.
Queen Elizabeth I commissioned Sir John Hawkins to capture slaves in Africa. And she gave him two ships. Those ships were called Jesus Christos and Grace of God. They were sent to capture slaves. Sir. However, in Africa, sir, this is the fundamental difference about African slavery and white slavery. In Africa, when a man was captured or a woman was captured in battle or otherwise, they were still considered human beings. Yes, they were. However, hold on, sir, I haven't finished. There's enough time. I'm here until 6 o'clock when The Simpsons starts. Sir, when white people captured slaves, they had to morally justify it to the majority of their population, who were Christian, who were decent people. They had to morally justify it. So the moral justification under the Eurocentric European white slave trade was that blacks are not human. They said that we were three-fifths of a man. That was your scientific definition. They actually had scientists determine this, that we were three-fifths of human beings.
What about Charles Darwin? He said we're all monkeys.
Sorry?
Charles Darwin, who was a white person.
Charles Darwin said we're all monkeys. Sir, I think you've got a little off key.
No.
What are you smoking, sir? And do you still have some left? You've taken us back to the beginning, where it really doesn't matter whether you're black or white.
Can I ask you one thing?
But sir, I'm not here to divide people. I'm just saying we ought to have an understanding. The word slave is derived from the Russian, Slav. It doesn't mean that they originated slavery. The pyramids of Egypt, built before white people even came to Africa, was built with slave labor. Slavery is a human concept, an immoral concept. So I don't blame white people. If you'd have attached a commodity value against the Chinese, we'd have had Chinese slaves. And it wasn't just black. It wasn't just black African slaves who were brought to the Caribbean. Indians were brought from India as indentured laborers, where you said you would pay their salaries to go and work. And then when they arrived in the Caribbean, you said they had to pay off their passage, of which they could never pay back. They were enslaved.
Same is true of white prisoners. They were actually,
seeing as you want to bring in white people.
I do.
The white prisoners. Of course.
They were sent to.
The white prisoners. So, sir, we have something built into human nature. Humans are natural.
Psychopathic.
I wouldn't so much say psychopathic.
I would.
But opportunists. Naturally opportunists. And we still have the repercussions of what took place during slavery today. During slavery, you said the black man was backward. The black man could not be educated. The black man was illiterate.
What about Obama?
However, sir, so you perpetrated stereotypes of the black male. You said that the black woman, is oversexed. That's because you were raping her. You said that the black man is oversexed. That's because you were using the biggest, strongest, blackest bucks to fertilize black women. Because you bred black people like cattle. Imagine, you as a black man for generations, hundreds of years, you form a loving relationship with your woman. You have children with that woman. only to know that at night time the slave master is coming in and fucking your wife. Only to know that when your children reach 2 and 3 years old, they are sold across the country, never to be seen again. From that period, the breakdown of the black family, that took place over hundreds of years. And then you wonder why it is that the black family is still broken down. Why it is that black men may have a number of partners. I'm not saying it's totally entrenched in slavery, but I am saying we ought to have a look at the sociological and psychological impact of slavery on black people.
The bastards gave their names to the slaves.
So, you sexualized, the black male. You made the black male off bounds. You passed your laws, the miscegenation laws, prohibiting the intermixing of blacks and whites. You weren't so concerned about the mixing of black women because the slave master bred black women. That's how we had mixed race children roaming through the society.
Now we have said,
but you kept your woman holy, precious. You put her on a pedestal. You made her a goddess, not to be touched by anyone but the white man. And if a black man so much as looked at a white woman, he would be castrated, quartered, hung, lynched, burnt. Are you aware about Coca-Cola?
Terrible, I don't drink it.
Coca-Cola, the ingredients for Coca-Cola was invented by Thomas Pemberton. I believe it was around 1886 or thereabouts. Now, Thomas Pemberton developed the ingredients for Coca-Cola. The ingredients for Coca-Cola was the cola nut from West Africa and cocaine. That's why it was called Coca-Cola. The cola nut and the cocaine. Thomas Pemberton invented it as a fountain, as a drink to be distributed at fountains.
He sold it for $48.
Sir, he was killed.
Period of recession.
Then he sold parts of the rights to the Coca, to what was known as the Coca-Cola Bottling Company, which then began to bottle Coca-Cola and distribute it around America. So it became mainstream. And do you believe, how was it that cocaine was taken out of the ingredients? Why was it? Because at the turn of the last century, white women began complaining that black men were getting high off Coca-Cola and raping them. So Congress passed a law in 1902 prohibiting the use of cocaine in the ingredients of Coca-Cola. That is the history of black people, the black presence. So even now, we are seen as criminal. We are seen as lazy. Look at that for one moment. How dare you suggest that the black man and woman are lazy? We were fucking slaves for 400 fucking years, working in the heat, and you have the audacity to call us lazy. When you invited black people from the Caribbean to come to Britain to work as nurses in factories and London Transport, are you aware that if you had a criminal record, you were not allowed to travel? So it meant you got the creme de la creme of the black Caribbean. Any one of you who's here from the Caribbean or Africa knows how you were brought up by your parents. Our parents were God-fearing. In fact, I would go even further and say they were right-wing. They were conservative. They believed in capital punishment and corporal punishment. They were conservative. Go read a book. Go to church. That was the black parent. How have we fucked up in this country? How is it? Was it by our own design? No, because I remember coming up with the black youth in Britain. In fact, that's how I began speaking at Speaker's Corner. I've been speaking here for 27 years. What brought me to the park was racism. The experiences of a black individual, a young man, speaking here at the age of 17, 18 years old. When I was 9 or 10 years old, I was walking down the street and a policeman stopped me under the sus law and asked me about a ring, a silver ring on my finger that my uncle had bought me. Molesting me. So that's why when riots happened in this country, I could associate with it. We hated the police, which was totally different to our parents. I couldn't even go home and tell my parents I was stopped by the police because they're going to say, why you do? Oh, why you do? And you'd get another beating from them. The amount of times that I have been beaten up by the police for nothing, I can't even count. My first criminal charge in court was where some white racists attacked me. About 15 of them. I pick up a stick to defend myself and I'm the one arrested. I'm the one in juvenile court in Marylebone Magistrates.
They tried to besmirch Stephen Lawrence.
I remember. We'll get to Stephen Lawrence. We'll get to Stephen Lawrence. Stephen Lawrence is right here. Right here. Walking down Queensway one day when I'm about 18 years old, minding my own business, a police van pulls up, drags me in the back, beats the fuck out of me, kicks me in the face, you black bastard, you nigger this, you nigger that. And then they threw me out of the van at the bottom of the street. When I went to work on the Monday, my manager was, in fact, I was working at a company called USAA, United Servicemen's Automobile Association, which was an insurance company for American officers who came to the UK. In Grosvenor Square, just there, my manager said to me, Ishmahil, what happened to you? You've been fighting. For me, it was nothing because it happened all the time. I said, no, I was beaten up by the police. He said, what? He couldn't believe it. I marked the guy's number. He marched me to the police station. And because he was a white man, a former military officer who spoke with the accent of the ruling elite, cut glass, it sent shivers down their spine. And he said he wanted to make a complaint, and they began to take down the complaint. I had to go back for further appointments. When he wasn't with me, they could then get back to their set. Oh, my friend, you know. And by this time, this was before the IPCC. Then times it was the Metropolitan Police Complaints Authority. It was the police investigating themselves. They said to me, it's going to take a lot of time. You're going to take a lot of days off work. What we'll do is we'll put a mark on his file. And if it happens again, it will be flagged up. I knew they weren't going to do shit. I thought, fuck it. Went about my business. You mentioned Stephen Lawrence. I'm just going through my own personal experiences. One day we're in Romford Ice Rink. I'm an ice skater. Around 18, 19. Gone ice skating. And I left with about three or four friends. And when I left the ice rink, I saw a group of white people. I saw a fight. So young as we are, always interested in seeing a good fight, we gathered around and said, hey, look, what's happening? And there was a black guy in the middle of all these white geezers getting stabbed. And they were stabbing him. So we were like, yo. So when they saw us, they stopped and backed off. There was about maybe 10 or 15 of them. And the black guy limped and jumped and threw himself over a wall. We're like, yo, what's happening? What's happening? They weren't saying nothing to us. They said, are you not? There's some more over here. And from around the corner, we saw about another 15 or 20 white youths running. Now we thought, fuck this. We best get out of here. There was one white guy amongst the four of us. As we ran, one of our numbers called Wayne fell and he was stabbed in the ass. The white guy who was amongst us, a chap called Roy Merrifield, turned around and began fighting with the white guys so that the black guy could escape. We ran to a field. When we ran to the field, another friend of mine had ammonia in his eyes. One was stabbed in the ass. And in those, we stayed in the field to nurse our wounds. In those days, we used to carry knives. So I went back with one of the other guys that I was with, saying we're gonna find this crew. And my plan was not to fight them, because I could not fight 20 or 30 guys. It's just to stab the first one in the throat and make a getaway. But as we're coming round the roundabout in Romford, police car comes sweeping around the corner. We throw the knife. We tell the police what happened. We went down to the square. The police didn't even take us seriously. The police, because we said, look, how difficult is it to find 30 white guys running around Romford? They then threatened us with arrest. An ambulance comes, takes my friend to the hospital. When we got to the hospital, there were about four or five other black guys who had been going around Romford. That case never made the newspapers. This was in the 80s, prior to Stephen Lawrence. These were the types of attacks that were happening against black people daily. Daily. Yes, sir.
There are quite a few black people in the audience. Have they all been subjected to regular police beatings? Or is it just you?
My friend, I will say this. I don't know, but let's ask. Sure. Have you experienced police violence and racism?
Have you been taken into police vans and beaten up?
I'm from Britain.
Right. Sir, have you? Sir, have you experienced police brutality and racism? No, you haven't. Sir, have you?
I was going to get arrested just because I
Sorry, sir. You've had experiences. Have you, sir?
Lost count.
Sorry, just you've lost count. You've lost count. Have you, sir? Have you?
Anytime.
Have you? I'm saying to you, sir.
There is a white guy. What I mean, I have as well. I mean,
in the
70s.
Are you Irish?
Not partly Irish.
He says, what about the white guys?
But the police, I'm saying is, I'm saying generation. I'm a generation before you. But I was stopped and searched and targeted by the police.
You were stopped, searched, targeted by the police.
Yeah.
Sir. There's a difference.
I know there's a difference. But what I mean is, I accept what you're saying.
Hold up. Let's deal with this shit here. At the time, was I in a gang?
Yeah, sorry, I'm asking a question.
I'm answering your question, sir. No, I was not in a gang. But I suppose the police thought I was in a gang. I was in a gang of black people.
It's a simple question. I'm not offended.
Sir, I'm saying to you, there were serious issues. And I will go even further now to say that many of those issues that black people were experiencing in this country in the 60s and 70s and 80s, that Muslims today are experiencing that very racism that we experience, and there is no media coverage. Last year alone, there was over 600 attacks against mosques and Muslims last year. Where is that? Sir, this is almost because they're there.
Where do you get the figure?
The Home Office, they're there. Racial attacks are now monitored. They are there. Sir, are you aware that on Friday, a bomb was blown up outside a mosque? Are you aware of that? No. Are you aware of it? He's aware of it. It just shows you. On Friday.
I don't know any news.
Of course not, sir. On Friday. On Friday. A bomb was detonated outside a mosque. The week before that, a bomb was found outside a mosque. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
A bomb was found outside a mosque. When the BBC reported it, they didn't use the word bomb. They said a homemade explosive device. How innocuous. It sounds like homemade cookies, homemade biscuits, because that is the way the media plays down these attacks. Are you aware of Lee Rigby, the soldier who was killed? Of course you are aware of it. We have to be aware of it. Look at how the media framed it. The media said a man was beheaded. Now, the autopsy report showed that he was stabbed to death. That's what the autopsy says. However, people are stabbed every day in England. So if you read in the newspaper, man stabbed on London street, you'd flick to fucking page 3 and look at some tits. However, when you say a man was beheaded on the streets of London, you think, fuck that, let me switch over from the X Factor. Sir, it grabs your attention. You have to look and consider how the media frames things and why. However, hold on, sir, I'm going to get to you. Sir, I'm going to get to you. I'm going to get to you, sir. I'm going to get to you. I'm going to get to you. I'm going to get to you.
A week before,
2 weeks before Lee Rigby was killed, a 75-year-old Muslim was hacked to death with a machete in Birmingham. His name was Mohammed Salim. He was 75 years old. There was no media coverage, no media reporting. Yet you want the world to stop as soon as a British soldier was killed. And in fact, Mohammed Salim, the 75-year-old, he's not a combatant. He's an old man. He's not engaged in war. He's not engaged in nothing. He's just, he was coming from the mosque, from worshipping.
Who killed him?
Yet Lee Rigby, a man who was in Afghanistan, killing
him?
Afghans. He's a combatant.
Death
is an occupational hazard for a soldier.
Who killed this man?
Sir, all they saw on CCTV was a white man with a machete.
How do you know about it?
How do I know about it?
Tell him everything.
Sir, because it's on the net. It's been confirmed. But you have to look for these sources because it's not on the BBC site.
So what are you doing? You search 75-year-old Muslim killed?
Search 75-year-old Muslim. No. No, sir. Sir, many of my dearest friends are Muslim. My friends are varied. I work in politics. I work in culture. It is my job to find these things. I research this stuff. I used to work for BBC, Channel 4. I produced documentaries about this stuff. I made a documentary 3 years ago called Age of Extremes. There's people in jail who shouldn't even be in jail, like Mohammed Hamid, who's been jailed for terrorism in this country. Mohammed Hamid used to come to these meetings. He said in one, he had a phone call. Anyone knew Mohammed Hamid here? Who knew Mohammed Hamid here?
I think I do. Yeah.
Remember Mohammed Hamid? He was jailed. Why? Because MI5, he used to do Dawa, the Marble Arch. MI5 sent agents to his store, pretending to be Muslim, pretending to want to get converted. And Mohammed Hamid, a man who liked to talk up things, he said on a phone, in a phone call to me, 7-7, that would have been breakfast for me. You remember the case when I tell you about paintballing? You remember the guys who were arrested and jailed for going paintballing? Why? Because it was deemed that going paintballing and running around with these guns could be transferred for the use of terrorism. Are you hearing me? The judge must have been smoking some fucking Nigerian hemp. Worse, he must have been smoking some fucking crack that they've confiscated.
If it's the case I'm thinking of, he was found not guilty. Is that right?
He was found guilty. He's now jailed indefinitely. He's been in jail for about the last 6 years, 5 years. Mohammed Hamid.
He had a nickname. Can you remember what?
Mohammed Hamid. He wasn't a nickname. What he said was, in fact, there was a joke that he gave to this MI5 agent. He said, "I'm Osama bin London."
Oh, that's it.
That's what he said. Osama bin Laden. Now, Hamid wasn't even the one who invented that joke. The joke used to be passed around here years ago by a Moroccan chap called Elias. And Elias used to say, they're looking for bin Laden. And I'm now, my name is now Osama bin London.
Yeah.
That was his joke that Mohammed Hamid poached, that Mohammed Hamid passed on to an MI5 agent, and he's now jailed indefinitely.
He was jailed indefinitely just for saying 7-7 would have been breakfast for you. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
And I'm going to research, but that's what you're saying.
Sir, there is now a free Mohammed Hamid campaign.
But that is what you're saying.
That's what I'm saying to you.
One comment.
That is what I'm saying to you. That is exactly what I'm saying to you.
From memory, four and five.
He took groups out into the countryside to do camping. And they said that the camping exercises.
Which one was found not? One was found on guilty. There's about five.
The black guy, I can't remember his name.
He's a cab driver now, I think.
Yes, that's right. That's right. He's in my film Age of Extremes.
That's right, yeah.
This is the reality, sir. So we get back to racism, and I'm saying to you that Muslims right now are catching hell because of living in a racist society that is using Islam as a smokescreen to launch wars abroad, to fight campaigns in Iraq, Afghanistan, Pakistan. My friend, I have to ask you this question.
As the control of the world or as a Jew Israeli?
As a Jew Israeli, however you see the world. Sir, we have British troops in Afghanistan. Why are they there?
Law and order.
Who's law and order? Do we have Afghan troops here to bring law and order? Of course not. So how ridiculous and how arrogant of you to say that the British troops are in Afghanistan to bring law and order. Who the fuck invited the British there?
I'm sorry, that's a stupid question.
Stupid question. Wow. It's a stupid question. Imagine. Oh, don't tell me you have the right.
Yeah, I'll tell you. We've got guards in prison to make sure there's law and order, but we don't have prisoners in the streets.
Hold up, sir. You said they are there to bring law and order. What right do they have to be?
I'll tell you one thing. The thing is, most terrorism in the world nowadays.
Most terrorism?
Is from Muslims.
Most terrorism nowadays is from Muslims.
Rubbish.
Absolutely rubbish. Sir, hold on, sir. That is because of your own prejudice. Sir, tell me, give me some cases. Give me cases. Bombs in Iraq the whole time. Hold on, sir. There is. We can say there is a civil war and a conflict in Iran. Give me another one.
Any cases?
What are the cases? It's because how you frame them, terrorism. Because the word terrorism has been hijacked. About 3 months ago, explosives around a university campus. No one called it terrorism. They were called, again, improvised, homemade explosive devices. No word, no use of the word terrorism. There have been 600 attacks against Muslims and mosques. A bomb found outside a mosque on Friday. A bomb detonated on Friday. A bomb disarmed 2 weeks ago. X amount of mosques burnt to the ground. Not once has the media called that terrorism. But as soon as a Muslim assaults a shopkeeper for getting the wrong change, we're told terrorism. We're told he's a fanatic, he's a fundamentalist. We are even now told in the Western media, we are even now told that Muslim gangs, hold on sir, we are told that Muslim gangs are grooming underage girls for sex. That's what we're told in the media. So they make these gross generalizations to demean and attack Islam.
You're talking about the Daily Mail,
talking about your broadsheet papers and your mainstream broadcast, the BBC, Sky, or what have you. I'm saying to you, sir, there is a campaign. Allow me to finish, sir. They have now successfully managed to transfer the word terrorism to be synonymous with Islam. So as soon as someone mentions terrorist, you automatically think Muslim. If we talk about a terrorist attack committed in Britain and someone says, oh, their name was Mohammed, you're like, oh, if their name is Abdul, Mustafa, Ahmed, you don't even question it, you look for no evidence. But if they say a terrorist attack was committed by Paul Jones, you say, what has Paul done?
He was mad.
What happened there? Who is he? Is he a convert? You ask more questions. Sir, profiling, it is done deliberately. Oh, sir, I'm telling you as a person who has worked in the media,
as a journalist,
I'm saying to you, sir, there is a deliberate campaign to marginalize and malign Muslims in the same way that they maligned and marginalized black people in this country. Formerly, they used, whenever there was a rape, they'd always say a black man was seen in the distance. Well, we all know that.
Let me ask you a question. Since hijacking began, hijacking planes, how many planes were hijacked by non-Muslims?
Sorry?
In the world, throughout the world, since hijacking planes began in the 60s,
sir,
how many planes were hijacked by non-Muslims?
Sir, there are numerous planes that have been hijacked, but you're just unaware of them. We have Corrales, sir. We have Corrales, who now lives in America. He blew up a plane in the 1970s from Cuba. He was a Cuban exile. And he blew up a plane in Barbados, an entire plane. Where is he now? He's in America. Sir, let's talk about terrorism. Well, let's look at the terrorism of El Salvador, Nicaragua, Guatemala, Panama, Grenada, Chile, Vietnam. In Vietnam, 3 million people died. America used Agent Orange, where people today are still born with deformities, where there are hundreds of square miles of area that is inhabitable. Now, wasn't that an act of terrorism? The idea of terrorism is to terrorize the civilian population or to gain political advantage. That was an act of terrorism. In Iraq, when they bombed Iraq, they used depleted uranium. How many people have died as a result of depleted uranium? The sanctions, the oil for food program. 500,000 children, beep Iraqis, lost their lives as a result of those sanctions imposed by America. Isn't that terrorism? You have a warped view. But one man blows up a cafe killing two people is terrorism. But when the Israeli Defense Force drops a bomb on Palestinian people, butchering entire villages, oh no, it's not terrorism. My friend, let me ask you this. And we'll go to Israel now. We'll go to Israel and Palestine. I'm not meant to attack you because I respect you.
I'm not Israeli, I'm English, I'm British.
You don't have to be Israeli, we're talking about Israel and Palestine
I'm talking about Israel and Palestine, sure.
And are you a Zionist or do you support the right of
Israel? It's irrelevant.
It is very relevant.
No, it's not. It's irrelevant.
It is relevant to the argument now. Why is it irrelevant?
I do think the Israeli government actively restrains.
You believe? He says he believes the Israeli government is active with restraint. That statement alone tells me you're a Zionist. My brother, let me explain it. The Zionists who live in Israel have no right to be there. None whatsoever. You are converts to the religion. Now, when I look at you and you say, I'm not from there, I'm from here, I know that. Hold on, sir, allow me. Sir, we are having an exchange. Sir, we are having an exchange. You will have your to Judaism.
What's Judaism?
You convert, sir. Judaism, many people would like to claim that Judaism is a race. Judaism is a religion.
I know.
I was in Israel. I was jailed in Israel. I was in Ramla given prison in Israel. Now, hold on, my brother. Hold on, my brother. We're going to get there. Judaism is a religion and not a race. When you said to me that I'm not from Israel, I'm from here, I know you're from here. How do I know that? I can look at you and see. And I know that the chances are your ancestors are from Eastern Europe. Am I right?
Yeah.
Of course I'm bloody right. How did I get that right so soon? Of course I know you're from Eastern Europe. Sir, because you converted to the religion. Look at you. You are white skinned. Do you have blue eyes? What color are your eyes?
Brown.
No, blue. They look blue from here. But never mind, you can be in disguise. Sir, if I said to you that I'm from China, you know there's something wrong. Wouldn't it? You know I'm lying or something just isn't right. I've got an identity crisis. If I say I'm from China, sir, when we talk about the Zionist movement's right to Israel, we're not going to go into politics, we're not going to go into history. We're going to go into biology. We're going to go into genetics. It is genetically impossible for you to have originated from the land of Palestine. Genetically impossible. We don't even have to talk history or politics. Your ancestors are from Eastern Europe. 25% of the Israeli Knesset are from Russia. Israeli Knesset government are from Russia. Many of them migrated to Israel as economic refugees because of the hardships in Russia. You migrated to Israel for better economic prospects. Sir, let's go into it. In 1918, a land consensus conducted by the British in Israel, in Palestine, determined that there were 3% of the population were Jewish. 3%. Jews were allowed to worship in their synagogues, Christians were allowed to worship in their churches, people lived together.
I think you got history a bit mixed up.
Yeah. Sir, what's mixed up about it?
Well, first of all, Jews were always suffering under the Arab rule.
Jews were always suffering
under
the Arab rule.
Not as much under Christian rule.
Tell me, sir. No, he says, but not as much under the Christian rule.
I'll tell you.
Sir,
if you allow me to finish,
please.
I'll tell you.
That's fine.
At the Wailing Wall.
At the Wailing Wall.
The Jews were not allowed to bring benches.
What did you
think? The Jews were not allowed to bring
benches to sit.
To be very secretive.
They were arrested for bringing chairs.
Sir, I do not dispute that when you have a dominant narrative, a dominant religion, in any society, in any culture, then there will be residual sort of oppression or against those faiths who are not from the same faith.
Not here.
In England there is, sir. Hold on, sir. Of course. In America, when they wanted to build a mosque near the site of 9/11, there was a big public outcry. They stopped it from being built. I'm saying to you, sir, These things happen occasionally. Hold on, sir. Sir, these things happen. However, sir, I say this to you. Before you received the land of Palestine, the British government had the audacity to offer the Zionist movement Uganda. Yes. They offered you a country in Africa to be your homeland before they offered you Palestine. Not many people in the world know that.
I know that.
You know that. Hold on, sir. They offered them Uganda. What right did the British have to offer the Zionist movement Uganda? What right did the British have?
I think the British controlled a large part of the world.
They controlled a large part of the world.
And in those days,
I asked you what right did they have?
It's simple.
What right did they have?
You asked me a question, let me finish.
Please.
In those days, countries used to invade other countries.
Countries used to invade other countries.
Very simple.
Very simple.
Look at the British Empire used to span.
The British Empire used to span.
Most of the world. Right to the British, because they invaded.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you, sir. I'm glad that you are the flies. I'm glad that you are
the British.
He says, countries invaded countries and built an empire. Sir, thank you for flying into the web.
All civilizations.
Thank you for flying into the web. Now let me start dining. Sir, that is why I say, Adolf Hitler. The world claims that Adolf Hitler is a wicked and evil man. Why? Because he killed 6 million Jews. Nonsense. Hitler is known as a wicked man because he killed 6 million white people. If Hitler killed black people, he'd be all right. He'd be a member of the old boys club. He'd be invited to Buckingham Palace for summer dinner in the park. My friend, but Adolf Hitler made a big mistake. He invaded white countries. If it was wrong for Hitler to invade France, it was wrong for the British to invade Africa. If it was wrong for Hitler to invade Russia, it was wrong for the British to invade the Middle East. If it was wrong for Hitler to invade Poland, it was wrong for the British to invade India and Asia. So that is what I said to you. Hitler only wanted what the British had, an empire. But you, because you are the victors of history, you frame Adolf Hitler as being just as maniacal. Hold on, sir. Allow me, sir. Sir, you will have your chance. You will have, sir, you will have your chance. Let's look at genocide, what you call Holocaust. The first successful Holocaust and genocide in the history of mankind was performed by the British in Tasmania. There's not one living Tasmanian alive today. Every single one of them was wiped out and butchered by the British. The word concentration camp. The word concentration camp did not come from Nazi Germany. The word concentration camp came from the British law under Lord Baden-Powell. When Lord Baden-Powell said, "We will concentrate
not the Second
civilian
World
population
War before that."
The Boer War.
The Boer War.
South Africa. In South Africa. The Boer War of South Africa. Lord Baden-Powell, Kitchener. The idea, the military strategy, was to concentrate the civilian population to stop food and supplies from getting to the enemy. Thousands upon thousands died. When we talk about the eugenics program, that wasn't devised under Nazi Germany, it was devised by the British. The cousin of Charles Darwin was the conceptual idea and the ideologist behind the eugenics program. Came from right here in Britain. So I ask you, to reframe your appraisal, in 1890, 30 million Indians died as a result of a famine caused by yourselves during the Second World War under Winston. By yourselves, my friend, get counseling. Not me. Yes, you personally. You, motherfucker, you. Imagine. During the Second World War, Winston Churchill's administration in India, 3 million died again. We go to the Irish potato famine of 1867, 66, 67, where over 1.5 million Irish people died of the potato as a result of a famine created by the British in Ireland. That's why I love the Irish. I love the IRA.
The migration to America as a
organization. They've been fighting for 800 years. Understand history. Understand how you frame it. The Americans got engaged in the Second World War because they claim that the American mainland was attacked. You bunch of fucking lying Big Mac munching fucking nugget eating motherfuckers. A bunch of liars. The American mainland was never attacked. They attacked Pearl Harbor.
Yeah.
Where is Pearl Harbor? Pearl Harbor is in Hawaii. Pearl Harbor is 10 hours flight from America in the Pacific. My friend, why did the Japanese attack Pearl Harbor? Because you were blocading their oil. You are blockading their supplies. The Americans were doing this. And that in itself is a declaration of war. That's why the Japanese attacked in the first place. But it's funny how, because we are only told one version of history, we're only given one version, it's indisputable. But when we tell another version as to how it happened, they're confused. Africa became liberated because of Adolf Hitler. Are you hearing me? Israel would not exist today if Hitler had not brutalized you Jews. But it wasn't only Hitler who killed Jews. The Polish killed Jews. The Ukrainians killed Jews. The Russians killed Jews. The British knew about the murder of the Jewish people. Everyone was killing Jews. If Jamaicans were in Europe, Jamaicans would have been killing Jews. They were all doing it. The point I'm making, sir, I'm saying to you, everyone was killing Jews, and therefore, if Jews deserve a homeland, which I believe you do, leave Palestine alone, because Palestine had no Palestinians, built no concentration camps. And Palestinians did not gas you. Palestinians did not steal your land. The Germans colonized you. The Germans butchered you. The Ukrainians butchered you. The Russians. So if you want a homeland, have fucking Germany. Have it. If you don't want that as well, have Britain. Have Britain as well. Have England. But leave Brixton for us black brothers. Leave Edgware Road for us Arabs. And leave Southall for us Indians. But have it. You have no right to Palestine.
Arabs,
he said, Arabs would much rather live under Israeli law. Sir, Palestinians are second-class citizens in Israel. You have built
in a woman. No. You know, 10%, more than 10% of the Israeli Knesset is comprised of Arabs.
Wow.
They have equal rights. And in fact,
equal rights.
They have more than equal rights.
You are expelling Palestinians. No. Building settlements, sir.
More than
in Jordan.
Because,
in Jordan.
Because
sir.
They don't even need to serve in the army.
Okay.
So they get all the benefits.
What benefits are you talking about?
Any Israeli Arab.
What benefits? What benefits can an Israeli? It's like saying blacks in apartheid South Africa got benefits from apartheid. It's nonsense. Israel operates under apartheid system. Sir, you have built. Sir, you have built a wall. Sir, it's not true. Hold on, sir. Hold on, sir. You built a wall. Hold on, sir.
A wall for what?
A wall for what?
Between the Israeli Arabs and the Palestinian Arabs.
How long?
Come in and commit acts of terrorism.
How long is that war? Yeah. Oh, that come in, commit acts of terrorism. How long is that war?
When you go in and
how long
babies,
is the wall?
That's acts of terrorism.
How long is the wall?
I don't know.
The wall is 416 kilometers. It is, hold on, it is twice as high as the Berlin Wall and three times as long as the Berlin Wall. Yet when the Berlin Wall was in existence, we always had the Western government saying it's a blight against democracy. Look at what the Russians are doing. Yet the Israelis build a wall twice as high, three times as long, and no one in the Western media says nothing about it. No one. No one. Sir, let me go.
Yeah, Israeli Arabs can go to universities, doctors, they get medical, don't get beaten up by the police, they can serve in the army.
Let me go even further.
Do everything.
Four months ago, we're not even talking about Arab Israelis now, we're talking about Jewish Israelis. The Falasha Jews, the Ethiopians, up to four to six months ago, they ran almost a sterilization program, a contraception program against Ethiopian women, stopping them from giving birth in the country. That is akin to running a sterilization program that what Adolf Hitler ran. That's what they're running to Jews. Sir, if you treat, of course, sir, are you hearing me? Sir, if you treat,
what you're doing is, sir, no, what you're doing is interrupting me.
He's saying that Israeli Arabs have rights and privileges in Israeli society. If they would treat Jewish Israelis, black Jews, in that way, how the hell are they going to treat Palestinian Muslims?
Yeah.
If you sterilize them. You were sterilizing Ethiopia. Are you aware of the case?
I've heard about it.
You've heard about it? I've heard about it. The Israeli government had come out and condemned the practice. They were sterilizing black Ethiopians, sir.
What does that have to do with Israeli Arabs?
I'm saying to you, sir, if you're going to treat them, if you're going to treat Jews that way, how the hell are you going to treat Palestinian Israelis? Sir, are you aware that the highest rate of suicide are amongst the fallacious Ethiopians in the military, in the IDF? Are you aware of that? Why is that, do you think? Why do you think that is? Racism. How many... Look at how racism in Israel is now on the rise, where blacks are being attacked in the streets.
What has one got to do with the other?
The fact is this, sir. If you would treat people like that, how are you going to treat the Palestinian Arabs, Israelis? How are you going to treat the Arab Israelis? Sir!
No, sir, you. Sir,
I was
you.
In jail in Israel. I was in Ramla Given prison. When I was there, the blue collar workers, most of the blue collar workers are Ethiopian Israelis.
Why were you in jail?
Because I was going to Gaza. I was heading to Gaza by boat.
Human rights.
Not in the boats that you saw, the flotillas. Before that. Before that. And there was 21 of us on a boat, bringing symbolic bags of cement, because the Israelis had banned cement from going into Gaza. So we were bringing medicine, we were bringing cement by boat. We were 18 miles away in the international waters, away from Israel, when the Israeli Navy came out and threatened to bomb our ship. Then we were raided by the Israeli special forces, who boarded our ship at sea, hijacked our boat, kept us under detention. Wow. And took us into Ashdod, of which we went to Ramla Given.
Sovereign countries.
What sovereign country? So we're in international waters. We are in international waters. And he says he's not a Zionist.
I said it's irrelevant.
Oh, you said it's irrelevant.
I don't care whether I'm or not. It's no difference. You said Israel's an apartheid.
Sir,
I challenge you.
You have no right to be there. You have no right to be there.
Apartheid.
Apartheid. Let's show you apartheid. They build a wall which is 416 kilometers. Hold on, sir.
And that is not Israel.
Sir, then what is it? Hold on. Let's get this right. Hold on. He said, hold on.
Hold on.
You said, hold on, sir. Sir, we are debating. You said,
you're shouting.
Sir,
you don't allow me to finish. That's a
then finish first. Finish first.
Sure. The wall is between Israel and the Palestinian countries, Gaza, etc., etc. It's a security wall to stop them from coming in, slaughtering Jewish babies, which has happened many times.
Sir, you asked the question. Sir, you say that you're the war. If that is Israel, what is the other country?
Oh my God.
You say it's Palestine. How comes Palestine doesn't exist? How is it? He says, hold on. You say.
It doesn't exist.
Sir, it has no status. Where is its recognized status?
UN.
Where? From UNICEF. From UNICEF. It has no seat. UNICEF. It is not recognized. It is not a state. Now, why do you think them? Why do? What do you think they're debating about? About bringing in a sovereign state. But you
Gaza.
Say, sir, I agree with
who
you.
Who governs Gaza?
I recognize Palestine.
Who governs
I recognize
Gaza?
Palestine.
Who's the one in charge?
I'm glad that you
that's
recognize Palestine.
Question.
However,
who's
sir,
the one in charge,
sir,
Gaza?
Why is it, sir? In 2000, sir, sir,
Israel,
sir, sir, sir,
they don't govern,
sir,
they don't govern
in Israel, in Palestine, in Gaza, in that region, in 2006, Hamas won the elections. What did Israel do?
Refused to recognize.
They refused to pay the taxes which are owed to the Palestinian people, which amounted to $800 million. That just shows you that it's a colony. You have money due to them, which you refuse to pay. So how, if they were a sovereign state, why would they need to go to you to get their money back?
It's called apartheid.
It's called apartheid.
What basis was it due?
Sir, Gaza, sir. Gaza.
Gaza.
Gaza is the most densely populated territory on earth. Oh, wow. Tell me what's more populated.
Jersey.
Stop talking rubbish, Hong New Kong. Jersey. New Jersey. Sir,
your mother did not beat you enough as a child.
Sir, it is recognized that Gaza is the most densely populated territory on earth.
What about Hong Kong?
But now he says Washington.
Denser than the area.
Brother, when this meeting finishes, I'm coming back to your house to smoke some of your Moroccan ashes. I'm coming back to your house. you're talking nonsense. And I will implore you, when you leave here, go and do some research. In fact, most of you have iPhones and other phones.
You can't afford to do
research. You can Google it right now.
You wouldn't be talking shit if you had done some research.
Yeah, here's your shit.
Tell us on what basis $800,000 was owed to Gaza. Tell us on what basis.
Let me just explain who this is. This is the Christian Al Qaeda. He couldn't quite make it to be a Jew.
Hallelujah, so I'm a Christian.
And now you want to debate. So now you want to debate.
I honour the truth.
What is your point, sir?
Okay, you told us that the Israeli authorities owed $800 million.
On what basis? Taxes due. Money's that they collect.
So you're saying the tax was already paid?
Sir.
So that tax was paid?
Sir, of course.
And they held on to it?
Of course.
Oh, sir, of course.
Hold on, sir. It wasn't just there. America refused to pay out its aid.
Aid, yes, it's aid.
Well,
that's the truth.
No. America and Europe. But we're talking Israel, not Israel. Israel doesn't pay aid to Palestine.
Doesn't
get
it?
That right. Hold on, sir.
Now, sir,
let me put this to you. Let's get back to where we are. I'm asking you, what right do you have to be in a region? You have none. Before they gave you the land of Palestine, they offered you Uganda. We have the Balfour Agreement of 1970.
And West,
sir, you have no right. You are Eastern European. You're from Europe. Go back to Europe. Go back to Europe.
Where are you from?
Poland or Russia? I can understand his confusion.
Sir,
are you a Christian?
I am a Christian.
Hold on. Sir, let's just go to him for a moment. You're a Christian. You're a Christian. You're a Christian. What is being a Christian? Isn't to be a Christian to be Christ-like? It's to be Christ-like. But Jesus was a Jew. So why aren't you a Jew?
Because
look at him.
Because
he is a Jew. Why aren't
Jesus
you a Jew?
Message.
Are you circumcised?
Listen to me.
Yes, in the wrong place.
Jesus said, I'm not circumcised. No.
Jesus said what?
Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations.
Your Jesus said, go not into the way of the Gentiles.
No.
Go not into the way of the Gentiles. He forbade his disciples from preaching to Gentiles, you Gentile.
At that time.
You Gentile, at that time. When did he change his mind? After he was crucified?
No.
When did he change his mind? You're a Gentile. You're a Gentile. My brother, let me ask you this question. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is God?
Why are you changing the subject?
Do you believe that Jesus Christ is God? Because now I'm attacking you.
That Jesus
now
said
I'm on you.
To preach the gospel to the all nations.
My brother,
Christianity
he said
is
I'm
for
here
every
for the
nation.
House of Israel.
Christianity isn't.
Who is
only
the house of Israel?
I'm not attacking you. I'm not attacking your faith. Hold on, excuse me, my brother. If you continue talking, I will bring immigration with me next week. My friend, this is what we're talking about. I'm saying to you, I'm not attacking you because you are Christian. We are just debating these issues and these points. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is God?
I'm not discussing the Trinity. I'll discuss politics with you because you want to talk politics. But your politics
so let's discuss
is rubbish.
Politics. Sir,
you talk lies instead of the truth.
Tell me what's lie.
You talk.
What's a lie?
Your lie is black supremacy. That's a lie.
Black supremacy. Kill whitey.
Yes.
You're right.
Yes.
And I'm going to start with you.
Yes.
Imagine, I started my speech by saying we are all the same people, regardless of sex, race, creed, color, sexual orientation, political persuasion, or religious denomination. Now he says I'm a black supremacist.
Yes.
What have I said?
Okay.
What have I said? Tell me one statement.
We're talking about killing the babies of Ethiopians, and now this was racist.
No. Tell me one thing I've said that's racist.
I told you.
What?
Killing the babies of Ethiopia.
I said killing the babies of Ethiopia.
Yeah.
In what context?
You said the Jewish. You said the Israeli government was killing the babies of Ethiopia.
I said that the Israeli government was operating what can be called a sterilization program against Ethiopian women. That's a fact. You don't know about it, do you? Because you want to read the Bible.
You
read a newspaper which is 2,000 years old, brother.
Okay.
It's out of date now.
Okay.
It's out of date. Ask this man, he heard of it. Just you haven't heard of it. So now I'm a racist for bringing it up.
Yeah,
are you stupid or do you just look like that?
Well,
my brother, it takes a billion sperm to fertilize a fetus, and that was the winner. I want to see what the other billions would look like.
Yeah.
Give me other sperm.
provocative? Yes or no?
Fuck it,
no.
I find myself sexually provocative. Nonsense! And my friend, what are you saying? You come in, you burgle this discussion between me and him. You stand right in the middle as though you are the main star of attention here. And you know nothing. What put you there? What put you there? Why? If my friend is Sunday, why aren't you in fucking church? It's Sunday. Why aren't you in church? Why are you in my meeting? Right in front of my trunk. Right in front of my penis. Standing right in front of my penis. Why?
It's you that needs to go to church.
You would rather stand in front of my penis than go to church.
I know the truth. Yes, you that need to.
What is the truth, my brother? What is the truth? Tell me.
Okay, the truth is, the good message for this world is a message of love. Loving God, loving your neighbour, and loving your enemies. That's a good message.
We can't love what we cannot see.
What wonderful message.
You can say love one another.
That's a message for the whole world.
My brother, do you believe Jesus Christ?
Not a message of division.
I'm an invisible white man. I'm not an invisible white man. God, an invisible white man, me must love a man I can't see.
Answer that you in your own time.
You're in front of me and you can see me.
You must love a
do
white man,
me?
Yes.
We love white man.
Of
white
course.
Men love white man. White men have money and power. Yes,
yes. We love white man.
No, that is not the loving way. That is your way.
No, but it's his
no,
way.
No, come I will on. Never do that. What I'm trying to say is if you talk about loving to people, I can see.
And she wants to give some
do
loving.
You love me?
She wants to give some loving.
Show me.
My brother, check one arrive, and you're now going to read the Bible again.
How can you show me love by standing in front of me right now?
What do you want?
Show me love.
She wants what you have, brother.
It comes easily to you.
Sister,
show it to me.
Sister.
He's saying he's showing me love.
Hear what, my brother. You can start here, which is 12 inches, or you can start there, which is 3 inches. Start your idea and work your way up. You understand?
See, here it's all sex, isn't it? It's all sex.
It's all sex, brother.
And you've not had me for 20 years.
My friend, that's why I'm
Jesus talks about love, it's not sex.
That is what love is, my brother.
It's caring
for love. It's love, that's what we were doing. Last night I was making love.
Oh, yeah, good. Was it to your wife?
To yours, your wife.
Are you glad you are?
That's a lie.
Don't you ask yourself where
that's
is she now or where she was last
why
night?
Why did she kick that's you out every Sunday?
No, my brother,
why didn't your wife want you
sorry for insulting you, sir. You know it's all in the humor of speakers. However, sir, you believe that Jesus Christ is coming back to earth, don't you?
Of course.
Of course he is. If Jesus Christ came back to earth and arrived in London, England, he would need a visa. If he arrived in America, they're going to send him to Guantanamo Bay.
That shows you don't know God. If you knew God, you'd understand.
Stop it.
God's bigger than that.
Forgive me.
You don't know God. Ishmael doesn't know God.
So let's get back to where we were before we went dropped.
Give him a tip, boss.
So we were talking about Israel. My friend, I respect this man. I've known him for many, many years now. I know when he first came up here and started speaking, when he was just someone in the audience, didn't have enough courage to really start to speak. Then he started to speak on something Christian platform. Then he started to branch out a little bit. And then he finds himself in this meeting.
Wow.
I remember him.
Years big man, no.
Big man, no. So my brother, before we close on this Christianity note, let's look at your faith and your Christianity, and Christianity in general.
Are you scared to talk politics?
Wow. I want to talk politics, but you want to talk about the Bible and all this stuff?
Did I?
No, you're right.
You're scared to
you're perfectly right.
You were being
right.
Aggressive earlier, saying all you want to do is talk politics.
No, he's perfectly right. I must concede, you weren't on that. It was on the fringe of it, because you came in as a Christian. I knew where you were coming from, and that was my own precept.
Yes. I thought you said you'd known me for years.
Of course, I said I knew where you came from. So that's
did
why
you?
So that's why I
do
assume.
You?
That's why I assume.
Did you know that I'm a politician?
No,
did
you?
Are you a politician?
Ah, you've known me for years.
Imagine.
You didn't know.
Imagine, for those of you who are tempted by Christianity,
EDL.
You're going to be with him forever.
Come on.
Now, anyway.
Be with God forever. Amen. Don't
we get
want
back.
That.
We get back. We were talking about how Islam, Muslims, are being framed around the world. How they associate terrorism with Islam and Muslims. Now I know you don't.
No, of course not.
What do you believe it is? Do you believe that just Muslims are extremists?
What are you talking about?
Do you believe that Muslims are extremists?
I believe that the Quran encourages violence.
Yes.
Rubbish. Okay. Okay. Surah 9-5. Kill all disbelief.
Hold on, sir. Hold on, brother.
Fight against
you said let's talk politics, and now you want to talk religion.
No.
Yeah, when I went to talk religion, you said let's talk politics. Right now you're talking Surah.
I'm talking violence.
Imagine. But your Bible, sir. Your Bible talks about violence.
Does it?
Of course it does.
Where?
My friend,
throughout
the Bible. Throughout your Bible.
Egyptian will fight Egyptian.
Right.
There was
I'm a Christian. You've established that. A Christian is a follower of Jesus. Okay? Where did Jesus ever encourage violence?
Samson, why are you going to that violence?
Where did Jesus ever encourage Gentiles?
Didn't he say go okay. With your swords?
So let's get hold on.
Didn't he say go with your swords?
He said, no. Your Jesus said, think not that I come. Think not that I think. No, he's Jesus. Okay. Think not that I come to bring peace. I come to bring the sword. I come to separate mother from daughter. Father.
No. You've misquoted the verse.
Oh, quoted it.
Okay. I've not come to bring peace on earth, but a sword.
A
mother, a man's foes.
To separate.
A man, listen. A man's
separate.
Foes will be those of his own household.
Isn't that violence?
No.
I don't come to bring peace. He said that equivalently. I don't come to bring peace. I come to bring the sword.
Against his household.
He said, I come to separate.
That is a prediction. Huh? Jesus' prediction is that after he's come, there will be violence against Christians. And hasn't there been?
My friend,
he said,
think not that I come to bring peace
on earth.
I come to bring the sword.
The sword.
What does that say? If a Muslim said that, you'd be quoting that inside and out as a quotation for violence.
What did Jesus
say? Now, what do you want? So all you do is you just misinterpret your own scriptures to suit yourself.
Jesus is saying,
brother,
that swords will be used against Christians.
I want to move on from you.
My brother, when Peter took his sword out, Jesus said to Peter, those who take the sword will perish by the sword. No matter what verse we bring up,
you will be able to interpret it to suit yourself.
No, yes. I tell you the truth.
So my friend, tell me this about your Bible, because many people assume that the Quran is a foreign book. The Bible is a foreign book. The prophets of the Bible came from the Middle East and Africa. The Abraham, the man who gave you religion, was born in Iraq. So what are you saying? You have adopted the religion. What is the religion of your country, of England? Stonehenge? What is it? So whether you go to Islam, Christianity, or Judaism, you are looking at a faith which worships the same gods, the same prophets.
No.
Don't Muslims worship Adam and Eve? Don't Muslims worship Abraham? Don't Muslims acknowledge Adam and Eve? Don't they acknowledge Abraham? Don't they acknowledge Moses?
Totally
you want to bring difference, and you are new to the religion. You are brand spanking new.
Yeah, yeah.
Brand new.
Anyway,
new. So let's get back to where we are. The real issue is, when we look at the term terrorism and see how Muslims have been maligned by that, we as black people have experienced all of that beforehand. You Muslims are new to the game. There have been 600 attacks against Muslims and mosques in this country alone last year. Yet the government, the media, the police, the security services do nothing. It is not exposed in the media. It is not ratcheted up so that there's a fear. In fact, the people who planted the bomb on Friday, are you aware of that, sir? That there was a bomb outside of a mosque on Friday?
I am aware of that.
Who was responsible? Has there been a profile on the media? Has there been any...
How many people
Hold on. She says the Islamic government.
How many people were killed?
Hold on. Which Islamic government? Maybe it was the Islamic government. Can you see the prejudice, the deep embedded ignorance and stupidity of you people?
But don't take it personally.
Hold on, imagine. A bomb is found outside a mosque on Friday, detonated, and she says, could it be the Islamic government that's done it? That's their own denial. That's their own racism. their own prejudice, that when a bomb goes off in your country and blows up people that you know, then you start screaming terrorism.
How many people have blown up?
Terrorism.
Come on, tell us, how many people have blown up? How many people were killed?
They detonated the bomb, so no one was killed.
Okay, so no one. No. So why did you tell about people being killed then? You're wrong.
What did I say?
People were killed in Nigeria. People are killed in Pakistan.
What is he on about?
It's just been 175
Madame, the week before, another bomb, Al-Shabaab. Al-Shabaab isn't in the UK, we're talking about the UK. We're in the UK.
Oh yeah, we can't talk about Nigeria. We can't talk about Pakistan.
What do you fucking know about Nigeria?
Boko Haram.
When did Boko Haram start? Who is the head of Boko Haram?
CIA.
When did it start?
Ask him.
Answer. You haven't got a fucking clue.
How many people
he just
know.
He's read the name Boko Haram in the papers. Why he knows nothing about it.
Exactly.
Nothing. But you want to stand up here like an expert. You are on politics, my friend. Maybe when you quote the Bible, you might have a little sound.
Boko Haram.
You have
no outlawed in this country. Why are Boko Haram outlawed in this country? Why are they outlawed?
All right, you win again.
For no reason.
Madame, Al-Shabaab. Where are Al-Shabaab? Which country is Al-Shabaab? Which country? He doesn't know! Madame, where is Al-Shabaab?
Sheep, for real.
They just know the names. Al-Qaeda. It's like when they would always say, Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda. And every attack.
Shepherd's Bush.
Yes.
Go on. She says Shepherd's Bush.
Boko Haram. The ignorance of these people is shocking. You know nothing about Africa. You know nothing about conflict. But all of a sudden you jump up like you know. If we talk about Africa and we talk about famine, you're going to tell me about Bob Geldof. If we talk about war, you're going to tell me about George Clooney. If we talk about AIDS, you're going to tell me about Bono. If we talk about orphans, you're going to tell me about Angelina Jolie. You know nothing, really.
I do. No,
this woman says Al-Shabaab. Look at you. I want to launch a vitriol against you, but I don't want to. I know I'm a lovely man. Should we meet afterwards? Why did you mention Al-Shabaab? In this country, she says we do not agree with them.
He was talking about the UK.
The UK. And so she mentions Al-Shabaab. And he mentions Boko Haram. Madame, how is it terrorism is on the front of your agenda when a Muslim or a suspected Muslim in this country perpetrates it? But any time it's perpetrated against Muslims, and we have documented over 600 attacks against Muslims and mosques in this country,
killed?
And now this is nothing.
How many people have been killed?
What about my friend Lee Rigby? How many people have been killed in the UK? How many? How many have been killed since 7-7? 52, 52 were killed in 7-7. Okay, beyond 52. That date in 2005. And now I'm giving you numbers. Well, how many have been killed since 2005?
Well, we know Lee Rigby's been killed.
Lee Rigby. We know Mohammed Salim was killed, a Muslim, a week before Lee Rigby. You didn't know that, did you? No, you didn't know that, did you? You don't know that. That's exactly what I'm saying to you. That attacks against Muslims, you are not knowing about. But rather than...
Was that somebody who was deliberately targeted?
Rather than him, yes. Rather than him say,
what's the evidence for
that? I don't know about this. Let me look into this. I should go and read.
No, I've asked
last
you
on Friday, on
how
Friday,
many Muslims
on Friday,
have been
sir,
in
sir,
this country.
Sir,
that's the question I asked you.
Sir, when you look at the number of attacks in this country, whereby Muslim suspects have been accused, the bombs have not gone off. There have been suspected acts of terrorism, but occasionally throughout the media, we will hear of them when they happen.
Oh, so there have been 600 attacks on Islam, but actually the bombs didn't go off in most of them.
Wow.
This wonderful
haven't
news,
you heard, sir?
This wonderful, sir, clever politician,
sir,
who knows,
sir,
all the facts, can't tell us
four weeks
how
ago,
many Muslims have been killed by bombs in this country.
4 weeks ago, a mosque, a community centre in North London, was burnt to the ground, totally destroyed. But I suppose we shouldn't talk about it, should we?
Yeah, of course we can talk about it. Then how many people were killed?
Should we talk about in your frame of context how many people were killed?
Yes.
No, it's the act of terrorism. And I'm asking this question. What are the police doing? Because it's only a matter of time before someone is killed.
I'll tell should you what
we
they're
wait?
Doing.
Should we
I'll
wait?
Tell you what they're
should
doing.
We wait until someone is killed before we debate the
I'll
issue?
I'll tell you what they're doing.
It's
they're
a
watching
nonsense.
These terrorists and they're stopping them doing
which
them.
Which terrorists?
As you yourself
which
have
terrorists?
Said.
Which terrorists? Muslim terrorists?
Muslim terrorists.
What
yes.
about white terrorists? There are no
They're
such
watching them as well.
Where?
They're watching the EDL.
Where?
The
EDL. You're a bloody nutcase. You're a bloody nutcase. You're a bloody nutcase.
Why?
You've got.
Don't you believe it?
Who says it's just the EDL? Why do you want to just blame the EDL? Why do you suggest it's the EDL?
They're encouraging violence.
What evidence do you have that it's the EDL?
Because they're encouraging violence.
What? I asked you a question. What evidence do you have? Now I'm defending the EDL.
Okay.
What evidence do you have that the EDL are responsible?
The letters EDL were found on a mosque.
On one mosque?
Yes.
On one mosque.
And the leaders encouraged violence.
And if those letters
are...
simply because letters are found on a mosque, it could be someone else trying to spark racial conflict. We don't know this. That is the very point that I'm trying to make. Last week on Friday, bomb detonated. The week before that, a bomb found. The week before that, mosque burnt to the ground. I'm saying to you, when these cases are happening, how is it we don't have BBC, Sky News, and all these other journalists on the ground reporting live? How comes we don't have pundits in the studio
Pakistan
explaining
Nigeria,
the threat, telling us that there's a threat
by Muslim terrorists?
Now he goes to Pakistan.
That's why.
You fucking nuts.
It's more important. In Iraq, they're planting bombs and killing people.
We're talking about bombs blowing up in mosques in this country,
Muslim.
And he's talking about Pakistan.
Oh,
he's talking about Boko Haram.
Oh, yes.
She's talking about Al-Shabaab in Somalia.
We
are talking about mosques being burnt down in this country, and he talks about Pakistan. Can you see how they want to deflect attention?
Oh, yes.
When a Muslim, okay.
Killing people is deflecting
okay.
attention.
Okay, so Lee Rigby's killed in this country. Fuck Lee Rigby. Let's talk about British troops in Afghanistan. Fuck Lee Rigby. Fuck him. You hear me? Fuck Lee Rigby. Fuck 7-7. Let's not talk about it. Let's talk about Afghanistan. Let's talk about Iraq. Let's talk about Somalia. Let's talk about Yemen. Let's talk about all the places where you have British troops, where you have Western troops in Arab countries.
Okay.
You're a fucking bunch of terrorists.
Okay.
You are the biggest terrorists. You are the biggest terrorists.
I oppose British involvement in Afghanistan. I'm against it and I bring the
Why do you think terrorism happens here?
However, when Michael Adamaloja stabbed this man,
he said British foreign policy is responsible. When Mohammed Siddiqui Khan was on 7-7, they said British foreign policy, British troops in Iraq and in Afghanistan. They told you clearly why. Who cares what it justifies it?
Who cares? Does it justify it?
It tells you why they did it.
Answer the question. Does it justify it?
How many Muslim attacks were there before 9/11? Sir.
Answer the question.
When there's a murder committed, what is the first thing the police try to do?
Okay, you answer my question.
I'm answering your question. When there is a murder, what is the first thing the police try to do? Okay. The police try to establish a motive. A motive.
Yes.
Now, when you have these people committing these acts of terrorism,
yes.
saying that
so
we
you
did
admit
it,
they're terrorism.
Saying,
you admit this
of course
is
I do,
terrorism.
Of course I do,
okay,
of course
is
I do.
It, is it just
when you have
That's
when you
question.
Have these people committing these acts of terrorism? They say we do it because of A, B, and C.
Yes.
The Western media say no. You didn't do it because of the war in Iraq. You didn't do it because of British foreign policy. You did it because you read the Quran. You did it because the Quran
no,
is the evil book that
doesn't
say
that.
They
say
that. They say it's
they
a religion
it's justified
making them do
by
it.
The Quran.
They say the religion say makes them do it. However,
Osama bin Laden quoted the Quran all the time.
He has never.
George Bush quoted the Bible. George
he
Bush
has
know what
quoted
you're
the Quran.
Bullshit.
George
He's
Bush.
A follower of the Egyptian Kutub. You know nothing about any of this
sir,
shit.
I don't know.
George Bush.
I don't know the verses
sir,
he's quoted.
When George Bush invaded Iraq.
Then tell me who Kutub is. Who is Kutub? That's who Osama bin Laden follows. Kutub was jailed in
Osama
Egypt
bin Laden's
because
dead.
He never connected anything in Islam with what Kutub was sustaining.
That's
brother,
you don't know this shit.
When George Bush invaded Iraq, why did he say he did it? He said God told him to do it. Allah told him to do it.
Which George Bush?
George Bush. George Bush.
He said God spoke to him.
Are you talking about the first or the second George?
Does it matter? They're both fucking.
Does it matter? You know neither.
Yes, it does.
You know neither of them.
The first invasion of Iraq.
You know neither
of
them. You know neither of them.
I don't know either of them.
You know neither
of them.
George Bush.
The second George Bush.
George Bush Jr.
Iraq.
He was
George
a good
Bush
Christian.
Said
okay.
he invaded.
Was he a good Christian?
He invaded Iraq to finish
because
what his
God
started.
Told him to do it.
No, he did not.
He said God spoke to him.
That's what he said.
He said God.
You don't know it. You don't. How do you know? It's got to be
true. He also said it. He said he was finishing off what his father started.
He said God told him to do it.
It was by divine guidance.
It was wrong. I do not.
How do you know he's wrong?
You have no right to say.
Do you condemn Hamas?
You simply don't know.
Do you condemn Hezbollah?
You simply don't know.
Do you condemn Boko Haram?
You simply don't know. Let me tell you this. I support every single group, organization, fighting for their liberation and the sovereignty of their country. Every one of them. Every one of them. Every one of them. So don't just isolate Hamas. I support every country.
Do you support the Taliban?
Israel has no right to be in a region.
Do you support
America has no right.
They do,
my friend,
under the UN mandate.
You say the Taliban.
Do have a right.
Who are the Taliban? The Taliban are the people of Afghanistan.
Are they?
Who are Hezbollah?
Are they?
The Hezbollah are the people of Lebanon.
Are they?
Yes.
Are they?
You just don't know, do you?
I do know.
You know,
I do know.
But tell us
you
what you know.
You really don't.
Who are the Taliban?
The Taliban are an organisation that took power in Afghanistan through the ballot box, were then voted out, and after being voted out, launched terrorism on the country.
Let me tell you a statement from a friend of mine.
Is that true, yes or no?
No.
He wants a yes or no, so I'm not monosyllabic. The black people you might know might
be
monosyllabic.
I've asked you, is
that true? I'm not answering
true,
yes or no.
Yes or no.
I'm not answering yes or no answers. Go and speak to the black people.
So you won't know. Say whether what
Sir,
I said is true or not.
I'll answer you this.
You're a coward.
I will give you even
you're
more.
A coward.
I will give you even more than that. I'll give you
a
bigger
coward.
Response.
You're a coward.
I will give you a bigger response. A friend of mine, the person who's probably the most embedded journalist in Afghanistan, a chap by the name of Ben Anderson, who recently wrote a book about Helmand and the region. Ben Anderson, writing his book, said you cannot tell who the Taliban are from the ordinary villagers. And that's him, one of the most versed journalists in the region. But you obviously know more.
No,
where did you get your sources? So we understand, sir.
I told you, the Taliban were voted in by the people of Afghanistan,
sir,
and then voted out.
Let me tell you what you
after
have.
They oppressed
let me tell
the
you what you have.
And oppressed
let
the
me
country.
Tell you what you have in
the
Afghanistan.
People of Afghanistan.
Let me
hate
tell
them.
You.
Hate them.
Let me Afghanistan. What you have in Afghanistan are a people who are unhappy with the American and Western occupation of their country. These are the people who have taken up arms. They are not the Taliban of what of when the war started in 2001. It's totally mutated from that. You now have a hodgepodge of people, villagers, armed men and women who take up arms to expel the Americans. What we have is the Western media and Western government frame the resistance against Western forces as being that of the Taliban.
So,
but they are not the Taliban as an organization. You have a hodgepodge of different groups who dislike the American presence and the Western presence in Afghanistan, and they are the ones who have taken up arms. So if you want to go by what your media say, if you want
to
say by what
the women can't go outside because of the Quran,
because of the Taliban,
the Quran says
because of the Taliban,
women shouldn't go outside,
because of the Taliban,
that is what the Taliban say.
Okay,
yes.
Okay.
Yes.
After Hamid Karzai,
yes.
After Hamid Karzai came to power, there were several news reports because women were still not allowed under Hamid Karzai to visit National Stadium, football stadium. Women are still not allowed to visit public swimming pools in Afghanistan. That's under Hamid Karzai, not the Taliban. What do you say about that? Under Hamid Karzai. But he thinks, it's just the Taliban. He goes by sound bites.
I would say,
you work by sound bites.
It's a Muslim country, but it's not a Christian country.
Then why are you there? Then why are Christians there? Then why are Christian troops there?
I don't want them there.
Then why are
they're
they there?
They're not Christians.
Then take them home. Let them go home.
If I was
they shouldn't
country,
be there.
I'd bring
they shouldn't be in Iraq.
Tomorrow.
They shouldn't be in Syria.
Yes,
they shouldn't
they
be in
should
Libya. They shouldn't be in Afghanistan. They shouldn't be in Pakistan. They shouldn't be in Yemen.
Unlike
they shouldn't be in Somalia.
I condemn all violence. You only condemn the violence that suits you, that you
is
don't
really?
Like. Yes.
Sir,
you won't condemn the Taliban.
I believe in revolution.
Who are totally oppressive.
I believe in revolution. I believe in revolution in this country.
Okay.
Right here.
Okay.
Right here.
What?
We
through
need
violence.
To
through violence.
Ishmael.
Sir.
What would happen to
power
you in
concedes nothing without demand. Power concedes
so
nothing
violence.
Without demand.
That's
never did,
you
never will. Because you're too happy leading
stop
your Bible.
Pointing at him in a sexually provocative manner.
How do you believe you're going to bring about liberation? Reading the Bible?
Yes.
Yes.
Because I've got a powerful God.
You've got a powerful nothing.
I have a powerful God who is a God of love.
Oh,
who is a God of peace.
Off.
Who is going to bring good things to every nation. Come on.
So read.
Come on.
So
what
you
Yes.
So if Palestinians want freedom, they should read the Bible. If Palestinians want liberty, they should read the Bible. If Afghans want liberty, they should read the Bible.
Yes or no?
Yes or no?
Yes or no?
Is what you like.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. When did you last say okay?
People learn to love one another.
Oh, fuck
but
off.
Nations change. Nations do but not
you can see the cloud cuckoo world that is smoothing losing. It's a nonsense.
If you're better off,
you may imagine. Imagine,
you go to Syria?
We have Western governments.
Come on.
We have Western governments roaming around the world, invading foreign countries, using weapons of mass destruction, bombing countries, butchering civilians. And he says they must read the Bible and learn to love another.
That's what you.
That's what you told us during slavery, motherfucker. You said he must read the Bible and be good slaves. Fuck you,
Christians.
Fuck you,
slavery.
Fuck you,
slavery is in the
Quran. You read your Bible. You read your Bible.
That's right.
We must read the Bible and be good slaves.
You're
to hell
no.
With you.
You
to
are
hell
a noble
Christ.
Savage.
There is neither Jew nor Greek, to slave nor free.
You know nothing
female.
About Christianity.
All one
tell me the name of one prophet from the Bible
to burn.
Tell me the name of one prophet from your Bible who comes from Europe. Not one.
Tell me the best.
You're worshiping a foreign religion.
So, we're not racist.
No.
In Christ, there's neither Jew nor Greek. Christianity is not racist.
You come from
you
us.
You are racist.
Hey, yo.
What's the difference?
My brother.
Yo. You're racist.
Devil. Professor Ashley Montague and
Devil. Devil. Yeah, devil boy.
Both agree.
No, I'm both
that life
God.
Began in Africa
devil.
6 million years ago. It means that we, the black man and woman from Africa and Asia, brought you Europeans into existence. By mistake, of course. By accident. But we brought you into existence.
So you're a black racist.
Wow.
I'm not.
Oh.
I'm not.
What have I said that's racist? I say you evolved from
black supremacist. He's supreme.
You evolved from
I've
us.
I've said he evolved
by
from
mistake,
us.
By mistake, of course. We shouldn't have brought you into
existence. Sir, the oldest bones, where are they from? Where are they from?
Silence!
The first country mentioned in the
silence.
Bible and the Torah is where? Ethiopia!
Africa!
Ethiopia
Africa.
Is the first country mentioned
Africa.
In your Torah
Africa.
And in your Bible.
Is that
what are you saying?
Silence!
You don't like
you're
it, do you?
You're from Jamaica anyway.
No, imagine.
No, I'm from Africa!
As soon as,
I'm
imagine.
Africa.
As soon as.
Mr. Shaka, we don't have any friends. Run away, I'm
as soon as. As soon as we say. As soon as we say, you came from us. I'm racist. What have I said as racist?
No,
because they could never
you
accept
came
that.
From us,
you wanted
then,
them,
and then you came from then, us, and then you increased, unfortunately.
Of course.
By mistake, of course.
By mistake, of course.
That's the racist.
We didn't
statement.
Do it by design. It was by accident.
Okay.
It was totally by accident.
It's genetic.
You involved just by accident.
Not by blood.
We didn't plan it. You involved by accident. Look at you. You're an accident. A sexual
shall I
accident.
Tell you, same-sex marriage disproves evolution.
Same-sex marriage
if it was,
disproves evolution.
Yes. Oh,
don't
if
know.
It was the Bible of the fittest, you wouldn't have women having sex with women because it doesn't work.
Can we Christian have Al-Qaeda. Suicide heckler.
You believe in democracy, don't you? If we all democratically decided to hang you, would you go with our democratic vote?
No.
Well, you're okay. An anti-democratic idiot.
Now, brother,
you are. You are against democracy, mate.
Let's talk about racism. I believe that we are all the same people, regardless of
I'm
sex,
not.
Race. I know you're different, you can see that. Sex, race, creed, color, sexual orientation. Political persuasion. However, there are these differences.
However,
there are.
However,
there are these differences that exist amongst us that we amplify and that we use for our own nefarious means to divide each other, to divide us against each other. I believe that we are all the same people. Black, to be black is to be no more superior than white people. However, and there goes the however again, the however is that we live in a system and a society of white supremacy, which puts the white man on top of that pedestal. That's why, when we look at black
nonsense.
Beauty, black beauty is defined by Beyoncé. Who defines
black
that?
Beauty is a horse, you
who
call.
Who have a black horse? Who defines,
black beauty is a horse.
Who defines the paradigm of black beauty? We have leave him alone, madame. Got molested. We have, when you look at black women, when you look at black people, you have black men and women straightening their hair. You have them lightening their skin. Why do you believe that might be? You have even within the black community, whereby people say, oh, look how you are
they
fair.
Go for tanning.
He would never understand that
never understand.
In many societies, even in our own countries in the Caribbean, the lighter skinned you are, the more prospects you have for employment. Yes. In our Caribbean. He wouldn't know that.
And Mali.
He wouldn't know that.
In this country.
He wouldn't know that. But he stands up like he knows everything.
I don't
stands up like he knows everything.
Listen and learn, you fucker.
I claim to know
a
more
plane,
than you.
A plane crashes in India. 300 people on board. They tell us two Americans, one French, one English. Fuck the 296 Indians who are on board. They don't care nothing about them. You white supremacy is still alive, and white supremacy suggests that the white man and woman are superior to everyone else below them.
So you're now claiming Indians are white? This man thinks Indians are white. You just gave an example of an Indian plane crash. You just said about an Indian plane crash. 296 Indians, they didn't die. They don't
when
care.
When did he say that?
This is white supremacy.
When did he say that?
Ignore him.
Were you the same at school?
Wow. He just doesn't understand it, does he? He's a suicide heckler.
I know more than you, Ishmael.
Do you really?
Oh, too?
Yes. I'm sure you do. Demonstrate some of that.
Just ask these people.
Demonstrate. We have just spoken about racism. I have just given you an example. I said a plane crashes in India. 300 on board. Two Americans, one French, one British. Yet the media refers nothing to the 296 Indians on board. As a result of that statement, you say, I'm racist, saying that Indians are racist. Where did you get that from? Are you stupid or do you just know what I mean? Where did you get that statement from? And everything I say, you jump at your own wrong instinct.
Why are you out here telling you?
Because you were talking about Indians, and in the same breath, and talking about white people.
And so what does that mean?
Did you say Indian?
Don't you speak English? Do you have problems speaking English? I can recommend a Pakistani English teacher for you. Do you have problems with
it? Do you have a problem with my English?
Yes, I do.
Do you?
Yes.
Okay, because you're a racist.
I love the way when we talk about racism, white supremacy, they will always call the accuser racist. The power structure, the white supremacist power structure. When we talk about the international community, that is white-based, based upon white countries, white domination. When we look at the economic institutions of the world, the political institutions of the world, we talk about the World Bank, IMF, international motherfuckers. We talk about the United Nations. All of them are head office in America. All of them are white-led organizations, white-dominated. The ICC, International Criminal Court. So we have all of the world's economic and political institutions run by white people. The World Bank. To be president of the World Bank, you have to be American. To be a president of the IMF, you have to be European. My friend, can you not see the racism that is entrenched? Can you not see that when there's a war in Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, that it is the same clique of white nations, America, Britain, France, Italy, Germany, Canada, America, Australia, the same clique who call themselves the international community that go in and invade countries? Can you not see the racism of it? But instead, I'm the racist.
Yes, you are racist.
The victims are the racists.
Please. I do not defend the IMF.
Who cares what you defend? We're looking at them as institutions.
You can't even hear me out.
I don't want to hear you out. I've had enough of you.
You don't want to.
I don't want to hear you out.
Start talking.
I will drown you out with my voice.
Your fucking vets calling.
I will drown you out with my tenor voice.
You're ignorant, Ishmael.
I know that.
Yeah, no. Yeah, you're right.
Join Smith over there.
I do not defend. The Bank of England, all the international monetary funds, as far as I'm concerned, they're run for their own interests, not for the
whose interests? The banking institutions. Who controls the banking institutions? Who controls them? Arabs, blacks, white supremacists control them. White supremacists. My friend, I agree with you, it has nothing to do with economics.
Don't
but there are whites behind it.
Don't agree with him, Ishmael.
The banking institutions.
I don't defend those banks.
Let's agree. Well done.
They're run, the Federal Reserve has been called the largest criminal syndicate on earth. And I agree.
Excellent.
Okay.
Thank you. Have a nice day. So my brothers, sisters, you will understand exactly what we're talking about. when we talk about racism, and imagine we have a man who then calls me racist for highlighting and identifying the very paradigms that are set by white supremacy. When we look at black beauty, why do we assume that Michael Jackson became white? Because of the powerful dominant narrative that determines that the whiter you are, the better you are. In India, the lighter skinned Indians are the ones who are considered the best Indians. The Arab world, the lighter you are, the better you are. In Africa, right across the world, we can see these paradigms whereby we are told that the more Africanized features you have is the uglier you are. The broader your nose, the darker your skin. We have black women who are uncomfortable with the texture of their hair. Look at the fashions and styles now. Who creates the Beyoncés? Who creates that paradigm of beauty? It's not black people. It is the dominant narrative of the society that creates that ideal. And that ideal is a Eurocentric ideal. Whenever you see a black movie or a black film or something in America, you see the black women with straight hair, the lightest skin, the straightest nose. They try to perpetuate that as the yardstick and the paradigm of black beauty. It is right throughout society. In Asia, would you believe the skin lightening cream?
Yes.
The sales of skin lightening cream.
Suck it till this day.
The largest sales of skin lightening cream is not in Africa. It's in Asia.
Yeah, Pakistan, India, I've seen that.
It's across Asia.
I'll have to tell you. The lady's about to get married. I have to tell you this now.
Sorry?
The lady's about to get married. They say, why are you so sad? Oh, because I'm dark. And you know what they call the cream? European white.
They called what?
The cream, European white.
They called them European white.
And then they fuck out. And they get married.
That is the reality.
I saw that a couple of years ago.
People do not understand this. They don't understand the depth of where it comes from. That is what happens. So when I refer to white supremacy and say white supremacists, I'm not saying that all white people buy into white supremacy, because blacks buy into white supremacy too. Look at Barack Obama. Barack Obama buys into the concept of white supremacy. We look at all of the world's political and economic institutions, the World Bank, the IMF, the United Nations, the ICC. They're all run by a white supremacist ideal. When we have wars abroad and they say the international community demands this or wants that, they're not referring to Nigeria, Pakistan or India. They're referring to America, Britain, France, Spain, Italy, Canada, New Zealand, Australia. They're referring to the white Western nations, because what they do now, formerly when they colonized countries, they would do it individually. They go to a land, seize the land, claim it as their own. Now what they do, they go under the guise of the international community, they use their military wing, which is NATO, they conquer countries, and then they sit down behind the scenes and they divide up the booty and the loot and the resources amongst themselves. That is the reality. So white supremacy is still very much alive today. If you want to stop terrorism, all you have to do is get Western armies, Western militaries out of non-white people's countries, because they are in countries, they're in Africa. America's just opened up 35 military bases across Africa. Why are they there? They are there to secure the resources. It's not just about oil, it's about diamonds, uranium, titanium, cobalt, oil, copper, iron, lead, silver, rice, coffee, cocoa, tea. It's about all of these resources. Why are they fighting for these resources? Because China, India, Brazil, other countries are industrializing at a rate that is putting heavy competition on the resources that are remaining in the world. And so Western companies are fighting to retain these resources, to retain control over the marketplace. Your economies are dependent upon it. We are in a global economic crisis. A global economic crisis. Have you not seen how the wars across the world have become much more aggressive, have become much more desperate? When you look at Egypt, when you look at Syria, when you look at Libya, when you look at Iraq, when you look at Somalia, when you look at Yemen, when you look at Afghanistan, when you look at Pakistan, they become much more aggressive, because now what we have is a war of imperialism to colonize and conquer and contain and control the entire globe. Isn't it fascinating how Mohamed Morsi of the Muslim Brotherhood, the Egyptian president, was overthrown last week and the Americans said nothing. They refused to call it a coup. What do you mean it's not a coup? Why would the Americans refuse to call it a coup? Because if it is termed a coup, the Americans under American law are obliged to stop any aid or assistance from going to the military, from going to that government. And Egypt is the second largest recipient of US aid. So that's why now the Americans refuse to call it a coup. The first democratically elected president of Egypt. And America says nothing. Britain says we must recognize change and move on. What do you mean? Could you imagine the first democratically elected government of Egypt and the Western governments who are always running around the globe trying to promote democracy are happy to sit back and allow the coup to happen. Why? Because they were the instigators and they were the background puppet masters of the coup in Egypt. Look at the coup in Egypt. Look at what's going on now. In Tahrir Square, we have people standing out in the millions, thousands, hundreds of thousands, with t-shirts of Egyptian generals, waving posters of Egyptian generals. When you see that, you know that there's a hidden hand behind the coup in Egypt. So I'm saying, we are in some serious trouble right now. Serious problems. The West are moving on their final push. Destroy Syria, sedate Iran, push out Hezbollah, and they have everything. There is no resistance, nothing. I said it then, back in 1991, and I'll say it now. The West will not be satisfied until there is a McDonald's restaurant inside every mosque. In every mosque. It is not just that, it is not just racial imperialism, it is cultural imperialism. Look around you. Look at how we're all dressed. Look at the food we eat. Look at the thoughts that we have in our head. Many of you are consumed by celebrity culture. Many of you are now divorced from families, society, community. Many of you are now chasing the dream of more money, of a bigger car, of a bigger house. We've become materialists. We've become capitalists. We've become vacuous. We've become empty. We are now sitting on the fringes as the rich are getting richer. The disparity of wealth in wealth between this country, between rich and poor, is the greatest it's almost ever been. Yet we allow it to happen. We allow people to have privilege. There is no debate. And Egypt will be no different. The elite, the generals are already fat. The people who threw the coup in Egypt, they're already in the pay of the American government. There's no democracy there. There will be no people's parliament, no people's government. In 2014, the military say they're going to host elections. How can you have elections in Egypt? What are you going to do? Ban the Muslim Brotherhood from participating? And if the Muslim Brotherhood are allowed to participate, what's going to happen if they win again? So it shows us, it doesn't matter. Democracy means nothing to the West. What matters is whether you are Western friendly or not. They will tell you about the Taliban in Afghanistan, but tell you nothing about the treatment of women in Saudi Arabia. Nothing. That is the hypocrisy. That is the double standards. That is what we all should be fighting for. Now, of course, earlier on, this meeting was distracted by the Christian Al-Qaeda. But it's a dirt track. Religion doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether you are Jewish, Muslim, or Christian. Religion, all of these things are issues that are used to divide us. So I ask you as I close this meeting, what are you going to do to initiate change? What are you doing to initiate change? Because many of us are happy and contented to go home to watch The X Factor, to watch The Voice, to be consumed by EastEnders, to be at the movies, to be at the party at a club on a Friday and Saturday night. But what is your social responsibility to yourself, to your family, to your community? What is your responsibility to society? And when I say society, I don't just mean the society in the UK. I mean the global society. The world is becoming smaller. Look around you and look how many nationalities and people there are here. I am an African, but I am also a Jamaican. I am also British. I am also Palestinian. I am also Afghani. I am also Pakistani. I am also Iraqi. We are all of these things, and we have a responsibility to stand up and fight against imperialism. When we want to talk about terrorists, don't tell me about Al-Qaeda. Don't tell me about the Taliban. Don't tell me about Hezbollah. Don't tell me about Hamas. Don't tell me about Al-Shabaab. Tell me about the greatest terrorist nation on earth. That is the United Snakes of America. The United Snakes of America is the greatest terrorist nation on earth today, bar none. The American government has over 800 military bases around the world. Let's look. In the last 40 years, there is no nation on earth who has killed more people than Americans. When we go to Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, 3 million people were butchered by the Americans. When we go to El Salvador, Nicaragua, Guatemala, Chile, Panama, Grenada, look at the amount of people who were killed there. When we go to Iraq, look how many civilians have been killed by American bombs, American missiles. When we go to Afghanistan, Pakistan, and it's happening right now under that black president in the White House, Barack Obama, who is worse in many ways than George Bush, because Barack Obama can get away with it. Barack Obama drops drones and bombs in Yemen, Somalia, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and black people don't say a word because they're just glad that there's a black president in the White House. White liberals say nothing because they see the election of a black man as progress. So Barack Obama has a license to kill. George Bush, in his 2 terms of office, used drones to drop bombs on Pakistan 52 times. That was in 2 terms, in 8 years. George Bush used drones to drop missiles 52 times. Barack Obama has just started his 2nd term of office and he has already dropped over 300 drones in Pakistan. Can you see the difference? Barack Obama said he was going to sedate the war in Afghanistan. What did he do when he first came to office? He sent 30,000 more troops to Afghanistan. So there are more troops in Afghanistan under Barack Obama than there ever was under George W. Bush. Barack Obama promised to close Guantanamo Bay on January 2010. In 2013, Guantanamo Bay is still open. Barack Obama said he was going to find peace between Israel and Palestine. Now we have war in Libya, of which he sanctioned, he supported, he endorsed. Now we have war in Syria, of which he is sending arms to the Syrian government. Now we have 35 American military bases in Africa that he assigned off. Yet, remember, the motherfucker won a Nobel Peace Prize. A Nobel Peace Prize, why? Because of you white liberals and white supremacy, which said, oh, what did Barack Obama do to win a Nobel Peace Prize? Nothing, he was black. And white liberals, short of black faces to endorse, gives Barack Obama a Nobel Peace Prize. The man who is responsible for murder and war. They might as well give Hitler a Nobel Peace Prize. Who should get Nobel Peace Prizes? Vinunu, the Israeli who exposed the Israel's nuclear weapons program. He was jailed in Israel, kept in solitary confinement. He should receive and Nobel Peace Prize. Bradley Manning, a man who exposed America's crimes in Iraq. Instead, he's in jail. He's persecuted. The Western media say nothing in defense of Bradley Manning. He should get a Nobel Peace Prize. Edward Snowden, who exposed America's eavesdropping systems. He is now held up in Russia, held in transit. And look at what the Russian says. Look at what the Russian Putin spokesman said this week. Putin's spokesman said, we will offer Edward Snowden asylum in Russia if he stops attacking our or harming our partners, America. It shows you the relationship between Russia and America. That's why I've always said you can never trust the Russians. Never. They will sell you out in an instant. Now they're saying, as long as Edward Snowden does nothing to harm their partners, that exposed the relationship that America has with Russia as to how they play the world. They use the world as a chessboard. They use the world as a chess table for their ideological wars. But the people really don't matter. That is the issue. So I say to you as I close the meeting, everyone has a responsibility to enlighten themselves, to educate themselves, to inform themselves. You can no longer keep blaming everyone else or something else and saying, I just didn't know. Because all the information is out there. If you want to, if you have an internet, if you have an AK 47, if you have Facebook, email, blog, MySpace, Twitter, you have ammunition. If you have a Google search engine, you have a PhD. You have all the resources you need to get on the battlefield to start fighting against racism, oppression, and imperialism. And I hope that some of you, after hearing what I've got to say today, will pick up your AK-47, will load your AK with ammunition, and start firing indiscriminately. I don't give a fuck where you fire, but aim your gun well and hit the enemy. Power to all people.
Yes.